Good morning to everyone that is viewing on Facebook this morning. We're so happy to have you with us for our Sunday morning service. Please join us as we worship and magnify the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, you are worthy to be praised. We exalt your name, O God, and we lift you on high. You are God, and beside you there is none other. You are King of all kings and Lord of all lords, and we honor your name. We welcome your presence this morning. Oh God, have your way in this service this morning, oh God. Touch every life present this morning, oh God. We honor you. We magnify you. We are happy to be in the house of God this morning. If you're happy to be here, say hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We bless your name, Jesus. Come on, somebody shout like you mean it. Hallelujah, Lord. We bless your name, God. We are worthy, oh God. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus. You come to praise God this morning.
Amen.
You come to give God some glory and some worship this morning. Hallelujah. Bless your name, Jesus. Clap your hands a little bit. Hallelujah, Lord. Your name. Hey. If you know this song, sing with me.
All the other gods, they are the works of man, but you are the most high God, and there is none like you.
Come on, help me sing.
All the other gods,
they are the works of man.
They are the works of
but
man.
But you are the most high God.
You are the most high
and
God.
There is none like you.
There is none
oh,
like you.
Sir Jehovah.
You are the most high.
You are the most high God.
You are the most high
Jehovah,
God.
Jehovah.
You are the most high.
Nobody else like
you. None, 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 none like you. Lord, on earth as on
deserving of it.
Say, let your glory come, oh God.
Let your glory
Shining like the sun.
Shining like the sun.
Your kingdom
reign.
Come on, somebody, bless the name of the Lord. Jesus, hallelujah, Lord.
Praise the Lord. Come on, let's give the Lord a great hand of praise. Glad to be in the house. Really, really, I was so excited just to be in the house again. You may have your seats. Those of you looking at us on Facebook and YouTube, we just want to welcome you in the house. Amen. And so we just want to send out a note that we are back at church again, and you can also join us. And for the wonderful faces that are here, so glad to see you. So glad to see you. So we are continuing with our financial and prosperity confessions. And we are taking the principle of Mark 11. And the principle is, you would have what you see. That is the principle. Not, he didn't say you will have what you mean. You know, we have a way of saying, I didn't mean that. You ever been there? And they get to realize, even if you didn't mean it, it have a certain effect still, because you got what you say, not necessarily what you meant to say. So sometimes it's, you know, we like to say, what a slip of the tongue is no fault of the mind. Well, I don't know where we get all those kind of things from, but it have no validity, because what you say is what you would have. And that's why we are saying we must learn to speak responsibly. And we must speak what we want to see happen. And so this confession, let's go to the next slide. We just all want to see it, and then I'll just go into the principle behind of it. So can we just say number 11 is, Lord, be magnified in my prosperity. 3, 4. Lord, be magnified in my prosperity. So I want you to know that is from Psalm 35:27, that the Lord, he is magnified when you do well. Let's get that straight. When you do well, it reflects good on God. Not so? Because remember, you are telling people this is your confidence, this is what you believe in. And now so people expect, well, if you believe in God, let me see what this God is doing for you. Remember, they cannot see God, but they can see how God blesses you. So by you doing well, the Lord is magnified in your prosperity. That's why you must not take your growth for granted. That's why you should always want to grow. You should always want to do better. You should always want to improve yourself. Why? Because it is reflecting on your belief system. Number 12, I am a giver. Let's say it again. I am a giver. Okay, and if you really believe that, let's hear it again. I am a giver. Amen. And because of that, I shall receive good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and run over. Let's try that again. I shall receive good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Now, that is something you must also believe. You know, I grew up hearing, you know, when they gave, you mustn't look back and to get. You see some of these things you hear, and it's not even scriptural itself. The Lord have always put a reward for us. Because he wanted us to give, he let us know there's a reward for giving. If he did not want us to look back, how would we know that God is faithful? Well, he put a reward system. So that when you get a reward, you could say, really and truly, you know, by my giving, by my blessing, By me being compassionate towards other people's need, that level of benevolence I'm showing, look how the Lord is gracious to me. You could come back and say God is true to his word, you understand? But when you want to say, you know, you feel is a holy statement that you made, when you say, well, you know, when I give, I don't bung back for nothing. That is not scriptural. Even in Malachi, he say, see, I want you to prove me if I wouldn't open the windows of heaven. He say, I want you to watch and see. Don't you sow your seed, you will get an harvest. And so he wants you to see that. And so if you are a giver, he say, you must give, but he didn't tell you to expect it from the person who you gave. But we expect from God, amen, that he will give us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and run over. And we have a saying, my wife and I, we live by our giving. But I want to close with this one. Job 110. This is something I want you to highlight in your Bible. This is something I want you to understand as a concept of prosperity, and that God loves to see his people prosper, and God is personally involved. Here it is. God is personally involved in your prosperity. If you remember the book of Job, the Lord asked Satan, have you considered my servant Job? You know, he is there's no man like him in all the earth. He's a very spiritual person, a very loyal person, very devout. And do you know what was the accusation Satan made against God in this instance? Not even against Job. He said, has thou not made an hedge about him? So who is he accusing here, Job or God? It's God he's accusing here. Has thou not made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. Now, if I want anybody to complain, that's the kind of complaint I want. You hear what I'm saying? If anybody had to bad talk me, that's how I want them to bad talk me. God, you blessed Stephen Mendoza, you put a hedge about him. Amen. Nobody, wouldn't you like a hedge around you? Wouldn't you like to know that when you build your house, no matter how much thief watching it, God say, they can pass. Because he put a hedge around your house. He put a hedge around your car. He put a hedge around your children. He put a hedge around the corn that you plant. Anything that you put your hand to, he blessing it. You didn't even intend to make it, but it's coming out good. They say, boy, like your hand is gold. Everything you touch coming out. I'm telling you here, look at me on Facebook here. When God blesses you, the enemy is upset about that. The enemy accuses God because he's blessing you. But God loves to prosper his people. He takes pleasure in their prosperity. So if it's one prayer you want to pray, Lord, put a hedge about me. Lord, put a hedge about my house. Hedge me on every side. Bless the work of my hand and help my substance to increase. Is that a reasonable prayer? That's a reasonable prayer. And that's a prayer I want you to pray regularly. Amen. Lift your tithes. Lift your offering. Those of you, when I come off, you will see the ways to give. Remember, there are three ways to give. Come to the office. Deposit in the bank. Or you can use online giving. Amen. Father, we just thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to give. And we thank you that the scripture is laden with why you want your children to do well in the earth. We accept that, Lord. And everybody says, amen and amen.
Welcome back. Stay tuned as we share how you can be a blessing to our ministry through online giving.
Using your smartphone, you can scan the barcode on the top right-hand section of your screen. This will take you to our giving page. By scrolling on that page, you will see the option to give. Once selected, this will display the various departments to which you can give. By clicking Donate on your desired option, you can simply enter the amount that you desire to give. Hit Donate. Proceed to checkout, then enter your billing information inclusive of your name, email address, and credit card number. Simply select the Make Payment option at the bottom of your screen and your payment will be processed. We thank you in advance for your gifts towards the continuance of our ministry. May the Lord richly bless you.
If you're interested in watching past services or even learning more about our church, we invite you to check out our website at www.ourmissiontt.com, where you will find lots of information about our church and even links to past services. You can also visit our Facebook and YouTube page.
Precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am so glad to see your lovely faces this morning. Are you glad to be in the house of God this morning? Amen. This is a good place to be. Amen. We miss the sanctuary. Amen. I want to send out our deepest sympathy to Sister Bev on the passing of her sister. And we pray God's comfort and blessings upon you and your family. Amen. Amen. All right. So we have been teaching on a topic for the past 3 or 4 weeks. Can you remember the name of the topic that we have been teaching on? Love. To have God is to have love, right? And so Pastor Stephen would have mentioned the meaning of love and then who to love. And I'm just continuing on how to love. And last week I would have spoken about how to love God. All right? And so this morning I just want to touch 3 points. How to love your neighbor as yourself. And that has 2 parts. And how to love the brethren. And so Father God, we thank you this morning for your presence. Holy Spirit, we ask that you take charge and take control over our service. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would minister to each and every one of us here today. You know, we have all come with needs, and so we pray that the Word of God will minister. The Word of God will meet every need in our lives this morning, O God. We trust you. We trust your Word. We know that your word is blessed and it is established in heaven. And so we receive that word by faith this morning. We believe that this word is for me because I am here to hear this word. And so, Father God, we thank you. We bless you and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Do we have any first-time visitors? Anybody come into church for the first time? All right, great. Okay, so how to love your neighbor as yourself. Mark 12, 30 to 31. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like, namely this. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. You know, Jesus commanded us to love thy neighbor. And you would see it as you read the scripture, how many times that loving your neighbor is repeated throughout the scriptures. Yet sometimes we overlook quotes instead of living by it. Isn't that so? We just read and we don't apply it. We don't ask the Lord, Lord, let this word become me. Let it become me, Lord. And according to Jesus, these two commandments summarize all of God's law. So when we consider how to love our neighbor, sometimes we forget the second part. What does the second part say? Anybody? Love yourself. Yes, sometimes we forget that part. Loving your neighbor and forgetting to love yourself. Jesus commanded, after all, is to love thy neighbor as thyself, which means to love your neighbor as best as you can, we must first know how to love ourselves. Right? And self-love is a continuous process. So whether you are now learning how to love yourself, or sometimes you have already overcome that, this morning, before we can learn how to love our neighbors, we first have to learn how to love ourselves. If we do not love ourselves, we cannot love our neighbors. If we do not treat ourselves the best, then we cannot treat our neighbors the best. In fact, if we believe that we do not deserve the best, Gertrude, our neighbors will not deserve the best also. Isn't that so? So I want us to learn to treat ourselves the best. So here are some tips on how to love yourself. Question: do you know you? Do you know you? Do you know why you act the way you do? There's a nice book that we recommend to our Bible school students, Why You Act the Way You Do by Tim LaHaye. And sometimes we do not understand, why would I react that way? Or why would I speak that way? Sometimes you need to learn why you act in a certain way. Sometimes you need a little counseling, you need a little therapy. You need someone to talk, to show you, to go back into history, to show you, these things happen and this is why you act the way you do. All right? So you should take some time off to spend with you. You know, we just take time off to spend with friends and families. You should take some time off to spend with yourself. We would call it me time. How many of us here have me time? Do you have me time? Learn to have some me time with yourself and understand who you are. Stop treating yourself last. Stop treating yourself last. Don't think about treating others first and leaving yourself last. Because you will treat your neighbor the same way. There's a word I always talk about that there was a point in my life where I just despised the word. Sacrifice. Oh my God. I remember a few months ago when we were having a little women's get together, and Sister Bev would have presented this lady talking to us about sacrifice, Beverly. And You know, many times we leave ourselves undone. We sacrifice now. You know the thing? I need to sacrifice because I need to get this and I need to get that. And she was sharing, you know, about sacrifice. And sometimes you really start to despise that word because when you're working, you get pay. You exchange your labor for pay, for money, right? So when you get your money, you would have already budgeted what you're going to do with your money. And plenty times, you are not on the list. True? You're not on the list at all because there are so many things that you need to do with this money. And you put yourself last. And you know that goes on for months. And then you start to think, what is the purpose of me working and not being able to enjoy a little of what I am working for? And so she went on to say that I believe her son would have done well or something like that in a game or something like that. And the husband decided to take them out for ice cream. And now they would have the opportunity to choose which ice cream they wanted. But here the wife now is calculating. Most women do that, right? Calculating. Me, I don't think I want any ice cream now because that is too expensive. You see this money? I could do something with this else with this money. I could buy bread. You know, we need some flour. I think I don't want any ice cream. So she sat there and she saw her husband and the two children happily eating ice cream. And she is saying to herself, I am sacrificing. And sacrificing is a good thing. Sometimes it's not a good thing because it leaves you undone, unhappy, unfulfilled. Am I speaking to somebody today? You have to have some me time. You have to treat yourself well. See, if we do not treat ourselves well, we cannot treat somebody else well. We cannot treat them good. And so it has to start with us. Make daily affirmations. And so affirmations are positive statements that are repeated to change negative thought patterns and in turn change negative behaviors. So when you look at yourself in the mirror, what do you see? Do you see a wonderful person? Do you see a beautiful person? Do you see a handsome person, a good-looking person? What do you see? An inadequate person? A person who is worthless? When you look at yourself in the mirror, what do you see? Do you see a confident person? Do you see a person who is worthwhile? The Bible says in Psalm 139:14, it says, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. And so that word, fearfully, the Hebrew word for it is yah. That word means we were designed to have the fear of God in our heart. Meaning, we were designed to revere God. We were designed to respect God. So we are fearfully and wonderfully made by God. Wonderfully, the Hebrew word, pala, which means distinguished or unique. Basically, it means God made you special and there is no one else like you. Can you remember when someone told you that? Let me just take you down memory lane a little bit, right? Can you remember, for wives, husbands, when you were courting and the fiance, most men say this, I have never met anyone like you. You are so different from all the other women. Kenny, you are so special. You are unique. Can you remember that, Natasha? You are different, Gertrude. None like you. And so the scripture says here that God created us wonderfully. There is no one else like you. You are the only you that God has ever created. Do you know that you may bump into somebody who would say, but you know, you look like somebody who I know, but you're not. You resemble somebody I know, but you're not. You're not that person. You're not that person because you were created uniquely. Amen. And so it is important that we learn. It is important that we learn to make positive confessions about ourselves. Yeah? Amen. And now that we are learning to love me, and it is a process, now we can try to love our neighbor. Amen. Now we can try. I'm putting in some love inside of me, so now I can try to love my neighbor a little bit. So we have some ways to love your neighbor. The Bible talks about this parable, the Good Samaritan, in Luke 10:25 to 37. You know, Jesus was always in the midst of scholars, wise people, educated people, and they were always trying to tempt him in certain ways. And this lawyer stood up and asked Jesus, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus turned to him. I mean, Jesus, look, he being a little rude here. He said, What does it say in the scripture? Huh? You're a lawyer, you're a scholar. What does it say in the scripture? And he says, well, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, and your mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, thou hast, he said, right, that is the right thing. But he now, again, want to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And Jesus told him this parable. There was a man who went down from Jerusalem, going into Jericho, and he fell among thieves. And what did they do? They stripped him of his clothes, and they wounded him, and they stole everything that he had, and left him half dead. I mean, we would have read about that in the papers, where sometimes they're dead. We would have read about those incidents, but they left him half dead. Who is your neighbor? And by chance, in verse 31, the Bible says a priest, a pastor, passed by, a man of the cloth, a man who's supposed to know right from wrong, a person who is, no, I shouldn't say he or she, supposed to know what love is, because to have God, Bev, is to have love. And so he passed by and he saw him, and then he went, the Bible says he went on the other side. He did nothing. He didn't even offer a word of prayer to say, you know what? You know, I am feeling to dirty my hands. He done have blood all over him. Let me just say a word of, he did not even utter a word of prayer. The Bible says, and after that, a Levite, oh God, the assistant to the priest. You can imagine that. What they're teaching in that church, boy? Passed by and saw that man and did the same. No love. Who is your neighbor? And he said, a certain Samaritan, and the Samaritans and the Jews, they were always at loggerheads. They never used to speak to each other. And so this Samaritan, he came by and he saw the man and had compassion on him. He felt the pain for this man in his heart. He felt it to the core. And he decided that he was going to attend to this man's need. The Bible says in verse 34, he went to him and he bound up his wounds, pouring oil and wine, and sent him, set him on his donkey or his beast, and brought him to an inn and took care of him. It meant to say that this man didn't just leave him in the hotel. He didn't just leave him in the inn. He stayed with him. And he helped him. When he was leaving the next day, now look at this. Who is your neighbor? How are you going to treat people you do not know? Or how are you going to treat people you know who deserve to be dead? You hear what I said? How are you going to treat people who you believe deserve to die? Who is your neighbor? And so when he got up, he told the innkeeper, listen, I'm going to give you this money to continue to take care of him. And if the money is not enough and the bill is more than that, when I come again, I will pay the bill. Now, in my opinion, it could have meant that this guy was a frequent visitor to that inn. So the man would have known him. That is in my opinion. So the man trusted him. He said, all right, when you come again. So it meant that he would have come at some other point in time. And Jesus asked the question, which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And they said, the one that showed mercy. Jesus said, go and do likewise. It is important that we don't get carried away with religion. Hear me today. And you can recognize who is a Hindu, who is a Muslim, who is a Christian, who is a Buddhist, and the other, we can recognize this. And I don't want us to get caught up in religion and say, well, the Muslim man deserved to die because he doesn't know Christ. Who is your neighbor? Because it could be reverse. It could be you in a situation and an unsaved person has to help you out. Who is your neighbor? It could be a person who is drunk, falling in the street. It could be a drug pusher, drug addict in the street. And as I said before, we could say if something bad happens to them, they look for it because they don't know God. But who is your neighbor? Will you stop still and do some kind deed to a stranger? That is the question. Will you give when there are a lot of people all over the street now with this big sign, $1 please? $1 please. Are we going to judge them and say, Or sometimes you calculate for the day how much of them working for. How many of you do that? Eh? We calculate. If everybody give them $20 by eight hours they're working. So we do that. Who is your neighbor? Are you going to express love? Are you going to be kind to those who are unkind to you? Are you going to lend a helping hand to those who are in need? Or are you too busy to stop to take notice of someone who is in need? I remember just recently, I think God was testing me. There was a lot of rain, remember, with the storm and Ida and et cetera, et cetera. And I remember that morning I went out early, and in coming back, my neighbor asked, you could give my drop out the road? I need to go by the hospital. My father-in-law was in the hospital. So I didn't eat breakfast or anything like that. And I said, all right, well, just give me a little chance, a little time, and I'll come back, and I'll drop you out the road, right? So I went home, and I had breakfast, and then I said, all right, let me go. But by the time I was ready to go, it was pouring rain, heavy thunder lightning. Kenny lightning, boy. I want to go in my bed, boy. My neighbor asked me to drop her out the road. I done in my house. All you know, and all you know it feeling? Right. Who is your neighbor? So I gone out the I gone. She came in the vehicle with the bag and everything. And the Spirit of God said, are you going to drop that lady on the junction? Or will you go the extra mile and drop her in the hospital? Spirit of God, I say, Lord, I cannot do this wicked thing and drop that lady right out the road to get a car in the rain, doesn't even have an umbrella to go to the hospital. I say, I cannot do this wicked thing. Took her to the hospital. She didn't even have an umbrella. I said, take the umbrella. You only umbrella in the vehicle. I say, whatever, whatever. Keep the umbrella because you will have to travel back to come home, and I do not know what the condition will be like. Who is your neighbor? Are you going to go the extra mile for someone you don't know? Are you going to help them in spite of how they live their life and whatever judgment they deserve? Are you going to help them? Last point. How to love the brethren. 1 John 4:20 and 21 says, if a man say, I love God and hated his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he had seen, how can he love God whom he had not seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God loveth his brother also. So here the scripture is saying, you hate your brother in front of you. You hate your sister, you hate your mother, you hate your father, you hate the dog, you hate everything that you can see. Everything you can see, you hate. But you really love God. Oh, God. I really love God. You didn't see God, you know. But you really love this God. Oh, Jesus. You really love this invisible God. You never see this God in your life. All you do is you hear about this God. You just read about this God. And always hear about people and you have not seen them yet. And you like them because this story sung is nice. You love God with everything. You never see him. You love him. But your wife, your husband, your neighbor, your worker, your friend, you hate. I don't like them. You have hate in your heart for your brother, your sister. How to love the brethren. And when I say brethren, I mean women, children, I mean everybody, male, female. It is easy to say we love God when that love does not cost us anything more than a weekly attendance service. Yes, I love God, so you're coming to church once a week. Well, now church opened back up. For now, it's once a week. But the real test of our love for God is how we treat the people right in front of us. How do you plan to treat them? How do you plan to treat your family members, even though they are disgusting, even though you don't like to be around them, even though they're difficult, even though, oh my God, they say some things they say, oh my God, they're so insultive. Do you plan to love them still? We cannot truly love God while neglecting to love those who are created in his image. The person who says he loves God with his lips but demonstrate hatred towards another in his heart is not being truthful. You call it another word, you're a hypocrite. You're professing to love God, but you really have no love in your heart. And so how do we love the brethren? How many of us here have shortcomings? Me, I have. I have shortcomings. What are you going to do about that? How much times you talk to the person to change and they are changed yet? See that habit? Oh God, I'm tired of talking about a habit. What are you going to do? You have to love them in spite of their shortcomings. Love the brethren, love the wife, love the husband in spite of, because to have God is to what? Is to have love. We are all there. We have to be able to forgive like Jesus did. Many of them came against him and he forgave them all. Proverbs 10:12 says, hatred stir up strife, but love covers a multitude of sins. Stop exposing people now. Love the brethren. Don't be exposing the husband with your friend. Oh God, cover the sin. Don't be saying anything about the one. Cover the sin. To have God is to have love. Love the brethren. Be kind to your brother. Be kind to your sister. Say nice things. We do not know what people go through in life unless they tell you. Sometimes a person could be going through a real difficult time and you cannot tell because they have a smile on their face all the time. They're always looking strong, eh, Brent? They're always looking strong. But you do not know by telling them something nice about themselves. Oh, I always look forward to that smile. You have such a beautiful smile. That alone, I tell you, can help them with the difficulties that they are going through. Show your love. Say, I love you. I didn't grow up in a home where my parents expressed love verbally. I grew up where they would express it with gifts. And so I never used to say it because, them never used to say it, so I buy a gift too. So you're supposed to know when I buy a gift. I love you, right? I love you, so I hear you have a need, I buy it. That is an expression of love. It is an expression of love, but I ain't coming out to say I love you because I wasn't brought up that way. But when you come to Christ, you can't get away from love. When you come to know this God, when he says, if somebody slap you on one cheek, what you have to do? Turn the other cheek. If they take your cloak, what you have to do? Get them the clothes too. This is when you come to Christ, you can't help it. Because he turns the world upside down. He makes things so different, but so loving, so caring, that you can't help it but love this God. Because he's so amazing. His words, his wisdom is so amazing. Say, I love you. Turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I love you. Yes, yes, Soren, tell mommy I love you. Right, good. Try to avoid the negatives. It's not everything you see you talk about. Even God in all his wisdom, listen to me people, Acts 17:30, even God in all his wisdom, the Bible says he winked at their ignorance. Of course, you had to repent for your wrongdoing, but God, it's not everything he will cut your tail for. And parents, sometimes we wink at our children's stubbornness and thing and we just let it go. It's not everything you get licks for. So it's not everything you see people doing wrong, you make a comment. You have to love the brethren. You have to be able to praise them. Never hold back praise. Or don't allow jealousy to get the best of you. Never hold back praise from someone that encourages them to do more. And I mean, sometimes you get involved with pointless arguments. Try to compromise. And again, practice kindness, respect, charity, kindness. We are building the first phase of Each One Help on that home, Sister Renee's home. It is almost completed. And we are continuing with the second phase. Practice charity, practice kindness. This is towards who? This is towards the brethren. You see, you're showing love. You're going all out of your way to express love to someone. You hear what I'm saying to you? Be there for people during tough times. Sometimes we do not understand how life will unfold and what will come our way. But we need to be there to be supportive when people experience difficulties. And so what? If you do good and you get back nothing in return, hey, that's okay. Because God has already promised to reward us when we do good. Amen? So let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Hallelujah. So, 3 points. How to love yourself. And I pray that if you do not like yourself, that you would go home and examine and talk to yourself. And that you would reflect on the scripture. I am fearfully and wonderfully made by God. I am special. And then love your neighbor. See, it's only when you love you, then you can love other people. And also love the brethren. Amen. And we'll continue next week. God bless you all. Father God, we thank you this morning for your presence. We thank you, Lord, that you're such a great and wise God. Thank you for your word. And we pray that we would apply the word of God to our lives. That will make us a better people, O God. That we can be better for others, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Minister to your people. Bring comfort to those who needs to be comforted at this point, Lord. Even Brother Andre, Sister Bev, O God. We pray, Father, for healing, deliverance. We pray for salvation this morning, O God. Father, you know each and every one of us, and you know our needs, Lord. And so we thank you by faith that you have heard and answered this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's take up our second offering. Remember, a few announcements. Our 5 a.m. prayer meetings from Monday to Friday, 5 a.m. to 6. We have youth prayer meeting on the Tuesday. We have women's prayer meeting on the Wednesday. And men's prayer meeting on the Friday. Also, too, on Monday, 8 p.m., we have Bible studies. On Friday, we have youth ministry from 7 to 8. And family time, family prayer from 8 to 9 on a Friday. And then we meet again on Sunday morning, 7. First service, 7 a.m., and second service, 9 a.m. Amen. Let's stand for the blessing. We are so thankful that you tune into our program today. This program is not complete unless we give you an opportunity to increase hope in your life by accepting the Lord Jesus as your Savior. Say this prayer after me. Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. I ask that you forgive me of all my sins and become my Lord. If you have said this prayer, you are forgiven and you are saved. Communicate with us through the following contact information and we'll get right back to you. Let me declare the blessings of God over your life. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We thank you for tuning in. For prayer,